Hello, I'm August Galoukas, and it's my pleasure to welcome one and all to the fifth in our free monthly virtual What Talk series, which, as I hope you realise by now, are focused on the various waterside hypotheses of human evolution. As always, please keep your microphone on mute until the end of the talk, when there will be time for questions and discussion. The talk is being recorded again, and I'll put it online at whattalks.com and the YouTube channel of the same name. So let's get on with it. Like others, I'm sure, I'm really excited and eagerly anticipating this month's talk. So I'm going to get straight into introducing Stephen to maximise his time window. Stephen Kunyane is a professor in the Department of Medicine, University of Sherbrooke, which is just 20 kilometres or so from the US border near Montreal in Quebec, Canada. His team at the Research Centre on Ageing works on assessing the links between deteriorating brain energy metabolism and risk of cognitive decline during aging. And they were the first to show that ketones can at least partially correct the brain energy deficit in older people at risk of Alzheimer's disease. I'm sure Stephen will be telling us more about the role of ketones, not only in the aging brain, but in the infant brain development too. Stephen has published over 350 research papers over the past 43 years. Among the first, and for me, one of the most notable, was a paper he wrote in the journal Medical Hypotheses in 1980, entitled The Aquatic Ape Theory Reconsidered. As far as I can tell, this was the very first scientific paper published about waterside ideas after Elaine Morgan's book, The Descent of Woman. So Stephen was certainly well ahead of his time there. Among the hundreds of other papers he's published was one co-authored with Michael Crawford that was part of a dozen or so that appeared in a special edition of the Journal of Human Evolution in 2014, which was dedicated to the possible importance of wetland and coastal niches in our evolution. I remember reading that and being amazed. It had always been so difficult to get anything on these ideas published in a first-class specialist anthro journal like JHE. And here was a whole edition dedicated to the subject. Professor Kunyane's also published five books, including The Survival of the Fattest and Human Brain Evolution, with contributions from more than 10 other scientists. He was elected to the French National Academy of Medicine in 2009 and was inducted as a fellow of the International Society for the Study of Fatty Acids and Lipids in 2016, and a year later received the Chevreul Medal, named after the famous chemist Michel Chevreul, from the French Society for the Study of Lipids for his research on fats, nutrition and health. So without further delay, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Stephen Kunyane.
Well, thanks, Algis, for setting up this series of talks. I'm sure in many, many occasions it's been a thankless task and you wonder why you bothered, but I'm glad you've pursued it. And it's obviously partly to celebrate the centenary of Elaine Morgan's birth. And I'd be happy to mention my small personal connection with her. My interests, as you mentioned, are primarily in relation to ketones over the past 30 years or so, why they're important brain fuels, and some of the insights that I think I've garnered from our work that seem to me at least to have an implication for understanding human brain evolution and why we're different from the primates, why the brain expansion occurred. So then it's a question of advancing the slides, which right now I don't seem to be able to do. There we go. I have a couple of disclosures to reveal about my work and the funding of our research and our honorary I've received. We have public sector funding from the government here. We have nonprofit sector funding from a couple of Alzheimer's associations in Canada and US, and private sector support for some of our work as well. One of our key key partners is Nestle Health Science, with whom we developed a ketone drink for people to protect cognition during aging. It's called Brain Expert. So turning to the topic for today, my link with Elaine Morgan and with human brain evolution, I have in fact visited her when she was in Mount Nash. I've met her at several conferences. I've got 8 of her books. And I just realized a few days ago as I was polishing my talk that it's been 50 years since she published Descent of Women, which was a book that was part of my reading list in a course as an undergrad. And I wrote a term paper on that in 1974. And it sort of gathered dust. And then during my PhD, my supervisor was the editor of Medical Hypotheses, David Horobin, and he encouraged me to clean it up a bit and submit it. So that's how Algis got to, and maybe some of you got to read it. And it struck me as a complete novice that it made a lot of sense that some of the things that we can't explain very well about humans today seem to make sense if we consider an aquatic phase or past in some form. So I just wanted to put that out there. And of course, the reaction at the time was complete denial or to ignore it or to ridicule it. As I mentioned earlier, my research interests over the past 30 years or so have been on ketones and brain development and on brain health during aging. And it's this interest in brain development that struck me as being relevant to brain evolution. One of the key people that I met must be 20 years ago now that helped me understand a few things about the concepts of evolution was Ian Tattersall, who was at the Museum of Natural History in New York City. And his book, Becoming Human, is a very readable story about human evolution and the limits to what we can really assume or understand from the fossil record. And the concept of exaptation, for instance, which I think is particularly pertinent to a larger brain. There's so many people argue for the necessity of the large brain and how it's helped us survive and on all this stuff. But in fact, I think it's more correct to think of it as an exaptation, which is a fortuitous advantage of something that develops. But you just have, if you're lucky, you can take advantage of that feature. And the other point he made is that natural selection occurs not for a purpose, but as long as it does no significant harm. Things will continue to change as long as they don't sort of kill the species. And it's, again, it's not for a positive purpose, but rather as long as you avoid significant harm. So I took that on board as I tried to develop this concept of nutritional constraints. So if we turn back to the sort of the difference between humans and other primates. You know this story, many of you probably better than I do, but obviously the cave art is one of the best examples of why we are so different. And the big mammals are so often portrayed, but I draw your attention to the salmon, which is also in the area near Lascaux. And this of course is not very representative of all the cave art that has been discovered. But the fish is relatively unique, and the holes that are around this square is that this fish was found on a cave wall, in fact, the ceiling, and it's still there, but it was almost cut out with a drill and then was being chipped out by a couple of Germans when some very irate Frenchmen found these Germans there. And of course, the First World War was on at the time, and they were told to bugger off and leave this alone. And this at this time was when they actually started to preserve Paleolithic art and other artifacts in France. But it was at the time that this, otherwise, you know, an hour later, this particular piece would have gone. The Germans would have had it. So an interesting, lucky coincidence for us. When we think about brain expansion, I think it's useful to just reflect on the differences across the big animals. And here the rhino, an example from Michael Crawford's work, where the brain is about 400 grams, I think, in the rhino, occupies a very small amount of space, about well under 0.1% of body weight, whereas the humans are out here at about 2%. So the brain is vastly different depending on the type of species you are. If we look closer to home, in terms of the actual weight of the brain, well, the big primates are around 400 grams. The early hominids were about the same. And then things started to change and move up to Cro-Magnon up here at about at 1600, and modern humans today are at about 1400 grams. So something obviously happened over the 2 million years of this evolutionary development, and it's never been very well explained. This is an old image and probably out of date, but it helps me remember that we're looking at primarily vegetarian species like the Robustus, with the big jaws and the plant grinding teeth, molars in particular, and smaller brains, versus the Erectus, which came along later and have been around for longer than humans at this point, had much bigger brains. And these sort of stylized images of meat eating and transforming from being plant eaters to meat eaters is the classic image. Thousands of these sorts of images have been published over the past decades. Sitting beside the water here, but no obvious link to it, which I think is probably a mistake. So the conventional explanation for the big brain, as I've understood it over the years, I think there are two variations, and perhaps there are others, but I think about two variations. One is that we developed stone tools, starting probably with Homo habilis, with very crude tools, but tools that eventually became useful to hunt. And the hunting allowed us to eat more meat, and the meat eating allowed the brain to expand. And these, again, are images that I've collected from mostly from the public domain, but the obviously classical images. The other version of this story is that the brain expanded. And because it expanded, it was bigger, it needed more energy to function. And because of that increased requirement for energy, meat became an essential source because of food, because the caloric density of meat is higher than in plants. So I just like to take you back to that. And this is a beautiful image of a stone point. And I actually don't know where it was collected, but some of you perhaps do. But the point is, to make one of these takes a great deal of sophistication and skill. And I do know that academics today that have focused on how that's been done have spent careers trying to fashion these types of stones. And they've already got large brains. So the point is that the problem with the classical conventional explanations is that making stone tools requires a big brain. So how could the stone tools be at the origin of acquiring a big brain? It seems to me the cart comes before the horse in the conventional explanations. And that brain expansion was occurring before efficient tool making was occurring, and certainly before hunting became as common as it did. So again, it seems that the order of events is not correct. And even if you're very liberal about these two points, the question is what in fact did meat accomplish? It was more calorically dense, and it did have some of the micronutrients, but was this really able to overcome the constraints on primate brain size at the time? So what we talk about these constraints, what is it that prevents the brain from expanding in any other species, in fact? And the main issue, as far as I see it, is what's happening during early development. And I mean in infants. So developmental vulnerability of the mammalian brain, that's all mammals that we know of. Lots of rodents and other animals are used in animal studies in laboratories, and it's been very well documented that the brain of all mammalian species that have been studied is quite vulnerable. And if you screw up brain development as an infant in any species, from a mouse on up to humans, then the function of the brain will be impaired later in life. So the story of brain evolution to me must obviously hinge on what's going on during early development, which is never considered by the evolutionists in general. It's more about males going out to hunt and being heroes, bringing down these big animals and so on. But it's not about the infant, but that's where, to me, the action must be and the explanation must come from. And within developmental vulnerability, the two areas that are most important are that there are certain nutrients that are essential for brain development, and there are very high energy needs. And I'd like to talk to you a little bit about that now. So when we talk about the brain selective nutrients, I want to just give you an imaginary neuron and a brain cell here, and just a couple of points about some of the minerals that are needed. To get a message sent from one end of a nerve cell to the other, there's an insulated sheath, an axon, and that process of myelination is critically dependent on copper. So there are areas of the world where copper deficiency exists, and one of the places, I think the first place where copper deficiency was demonstrated to be of importance was in agriculture in New Zealand with hypomyelination, because there simply wasn't enough copper, and sheep were not able to stand up because they were hypomyelinated. So that's one example that we've since learned applies to humans as well. I won't go into a lot of detail about these minerals, but you can certainly learn about this if you wish. And the person who put docosahexaenoic acid on the map was Michael Crawford back in the 70s. So it's going on 50 years as well for him. This has been the most accepted brain selective nutrient, but it's certainly not the only one. And my concern about DHA is simply that if it all depended on DHA, I think it's a very tenuous theory, but DHA is not alone. And what I want to mention in particular is iodine and iron and to some extent selenium, but particularly I'd like to expand briefly on iodine, because these are very important minerals for early brain development. And this is a classic example of goiter in Africa due to iodine deficiency. We've learned to iodize salt. It's about 100 years ago now that iodine was demonstrated as important to prevent goiter. And it was in the Midwestern United States where this was first applied. It's still the commonest nutrient deficiency in the world today. And it causes goiter and suboptimal intelligence in about a billion people. 20% of the world's population is iodine deficient, and that is despite the presence of iodized salt that is available. You can imagine how bad it would be if we hadn't actually discovered that iodizing salt would solve this problem. It's also reemerging today because the obvious sources of salt, of iodine rather today, partly salt, but also of foods that are rich in iodine, are being consumed less today, as I'll elaborate in a moment. So this is actually an issue in pregnant women in several countries now, that borderline iodine deficiency is reemerging today, despite iodized salt. So to me, if iodine is affecting the way the brain develops today, it must have been a constraint or a factor that would have affected brain evolution in the past. And the bottom line is that iodine deficiency is extremely uncommon where fish and shellfish are consumed. And this is an example from Western Canada, in which you see crabs here and large shellfish and so on. And when I saw this image in a magazine, I made a trip out west to Western Canada just to see and experience this amazing intertidal zone. Now, I just want to move my image here. There we go. So what you find in the foods in this intertidal zone, in the shellfish here, is a very rich source of iodine, iron, selenium, zinc, and copper. And I calculated several years ago that if we look at the amounts of these minerals that are required on a daily basis, how much of these major food groups would you need to consume in order to meet your daily requirement for these minerals, which are all needed by the brain? And these are rough calculations, but to me, it was less than a kilogram of shellfish would be required per day, but about twice that for eggs, maybe three times that for fish. And as you go down towards meat, nuts, vegetables, and fruit, you'd need 10 times that. You'd need 10 kilos of fruit or vegetables in order to meet your requirements for all of these five minerals that are very important for brain development. So any amount of fish or shellfish would be beneficial to achieve the requirements for these minerals if you were eating predominantly vegetables and fruit. Any amount, even one mollusk or a clam or whatever that you could find on the shores of lakes or on a seashore would improve your chances of meeting these requirements for brain development. So it's obvious that shellfish would have been advantageous for brain evolution. The other aspect, besides the nutrients that were important for brain development, is the energetic cost of building this brain. And the most amazing part of this story to me is that in a newborn of 3.5 kilos with a brain weight of about 400 grams, 74% of the energy that baby consumes is going to fuel the brain. And it's an organ that doesn't even work for the first few years of life. You can't survive. Let's say a precocious kid can possibly survive as of 5 years old. But those first 5 years, the brain is consuming enormous amount of energy. How did natural selection permit that vulnerability to occur, that huge energy demand on an organ that doesn't even work well compared to an infant chimpanzee that can grab onto its mom's back hairs and go through the trees with her or climb around on the ground, whatever it is, and is much more functional in terms of survival than a human infant. Critical for this is the question of body fat, because where the infants are born with body fat, and those with lower amounts of body fat have a higher risk of neurodevelopmental delay, prematurity, for instance. So again, this body fat is not just a decoration. It's actually functionally extremely important for the survival of the infant. And if the brain development is slowed down by in a premature infant, the chances of it becoming a normal adult are greatly reduced. And this business of meeting the brain's energy requirements comes from the partnership between glucose and ketones in meeting the brain's fuel requirements. So the main fuel of the brain is definitely glucose, as it is for other organs. But the idea that there are partnerships or other fuels that are important, like a hybrid car, ketones and glucose form a partnership to meet the brain's energy requirements, which is not the case in other organs. Other organs will function on fatty acids that are on our fat stores, like muscle, the heart, kidneys, and so on. The brain cannot use fatty acids as a fuel. It's obligatorily dependent on ketones. And that most of the glucose uptake in the brain is not sensitive to insulin. So it's not a question of pouring in more glucose by eating more carbohydrate. It's a question of having the control mechanism by insulin, which I won't go into today, that allows this partnership to function. So ketones are important as a brain fuel. And in fact, if we look at what's going on in the infant, infants are born with mild ketosis. It's totally normal. It's something that's feared by many physicians, ketosis as a sign of diabetic ketoacidosis. But this is a mild form of ketonemia, which is totally normal. So infants are normally in ketosis, and they're generating ketones from the medium chain fats in their milk and from the long chain fats in their infant stores, in their fat stores. Infants are able to burn ketones, the brain is able to burn ketones much more effectively than in adults. And the ketones are not only supplying 30% of brain energy requirements 24/7, which means they're an essential fuel in infant development, but they're also supplying the substrates to make what you see here in white, the white matter of the brain, which is to make the lipids that make those axons, the myelination of axons, which involves cholesterol and saturated fatty acids. So they're a substrate to build the brain and to run the brain. So the fats that are used for this process are absorbed very rapidly from the infant and in adults. If you're to take medium chain fats as a supplement, which you can buy in the health food shop, there's a very rapid absorption up the portal vein, whereas the long chain fats that we absorb are that we eat are mostly absorbed through the lymphatic system, and they go through the peripheral circulation and in dribs and drabs will end up in the liver, but they're not a very efficient source of ketogenic fats compared to the medium chain fatty acids. So this system is set up so that if you do have medium chain fatty acids coming in, if you're an infant consuming mother's milk, you have a sort of a turbocharged system to get ketones directly into the brain. So if we look at what's involved in this process, this metabolic change, the ketones and medium chain fatty acids in milk, that's a property of all mammals. All mammals have medium chain fatty acids, and their infants can, while they're suckling, can produce ketones. So that doesn't distinguish humans from other mammals, whether they're, in fact, the first medium chain fatty acids were identified in goat's milk. So goats are producing ketones for sure, but they're not an intelligent species. So what was different? That's kind of a baseline for all mammals. What seemed to be important then is to allow brain expansion to occur during fetal development, and that required longer gestation. So primates have longer gestation than the non-primate mammals. But again, as you know, other primates are not as intelligent as humans. And so what's different again about primates that allowed some further brain evolution to occur in humans? And I would argue that it's the fat babies that became the crucial difference. First of all, they make more efficient use of ketones, but they also are able to store some of those medium chain fatty acids that are absorbed from milk in their fat, sort of to extend the phase of ketogenesis. Because they have the fat stores to do it. So they have that reserve, that energy reserve that other primates don't have. And this gives the brain the insurance it needs to be guaranteed its fuel supply day in, day out. This is what an imaging machine will show. If you took imaginary slices through a living baby, the fat cheeks, as you know, the torso as well, and on the thighs especially. So there's a fair amount of fat. It's not the fat we should worry about in obesity today, which is the fat associated with visceral fat. It's subcutaneous fat, which is much less harmful in terms of long-term consequences of obesity. It represents about 15% of body weight in a normal term birth. And it's, as I said, it's about 90% subcutaneous. It's a rich source, not only of energy, but of certain fatty acids needed by the brain, such as DHA. So there's a form of energy insurance, but also DHA insurance to help build the brain. And it develops in the last trimester of pregnancy. So at 25 weeks, an infant has about 25 grams of fat, and then the amount goes up to about 75 at 30 grams, 250 at 35 weeks, and about 500 grams at a normal term birth. So it represents about 12 to 14% of body weight. It represents a good source of DHA, and it's about 500 grams of fuel. The importance of this occurring is that if an infant is born preterm, that's a period we know associated with higher neurodevelopmental issues, and it's a time when there's much less body fat. So again, it seems to be relevant to the successful development of the brain postnatally. There's a huge investment of energy during gestation to make sure that the infant is born with an adequate supply of fuel on board. So we see in a small child here with the chubby cheeks and so on and the huge brain with its mom. This is a picture from Michael Crawford. Compared to a chimpanzee infant, it's also got a relatively large brain at birth, but is very skinny. And so it's got a more functional brain, but its brain size is gonna plateau relatively soon in life. And so the investment in the thought processes that is going on here and slow cognitive development is not going on here. The advantage for the chimpanzee infant is that there's not it doesn't face the same challenge of meeting the energy requirements of this big-brained infant. So if we put this in the context of brain evolution, I think we can make a good scientific theory needs to be able to make a prediction. A good scientific theory needs to have to be as simple as possible. And it obviously needs plausibility. And I'd like to go through these points with a couple of examples. The prediction being that if the vulnerability of the brain is important during early development, we should see this as having consequences in our lives today. The issue of parsimony, simple explanations are better, and I would argue that we are still in a shore dependent phase nutritionally of our evolution. We have not escaped this particular phase of evolution. And the plausibility is that the remains are present in the fossil record of fish and shellfish consumption, going back to at least the early hominins. So prediction, I showed you this image earlier, but there's an interesting point here that the Cro-Magnon 25,000 years ago, 25, maybe 40,000 years ago, had bigger brains than we do now. Is that a blip in the fossil record? Is that one of the anomalies that things go up and down and you can't take a few examples and draw large conclusions? Well, possibly. But by the same token, this is a 200 gram difference in brain size over the past 25,000 years. Is it a question of having changed our dietary habits? That's something we'll have to see in the future, but you could predict that if we weren't meeting our brain energy and nutrient requirements as well as they were, that would be a potential consequence. We can see over time whether that pans out. What is clear is that neurological issues are the socio-medical challenge of the 21st century today. They represent 13% of global disease burden and 35% of disease burden in Europe. These are according to statistics that are getting old now, but brain disorders by any scale are a big issue for us all. Part of this is due to a deficiency of iodine and iron, which are the two main nutrients that are affecting the world's population, the deficiencies of which are affecting the world's population today. Iron supplementation has been available for quite some time, and it's still not very effectively used. And iodine, as I mentioned earlier. So these are two major limitations that still the brain still confronts and is vulnerable to. Added to which, as we get into the 21st century, the population is less and less healthy with obesity and type 2 diabetes, not only striking adults and adolescents, but children as well. And part of the issue, which I won't go into and perhaps we can discuss, is the relevance for brain function in relation to the ketones that should be produced that are not produced as effectively as a key alternate fuel to help meet brain energy requirements. And we know that ketones and some of these nutrients are critical in the management of certain diseases, neurodegenerative diseases. I work on Alzheimer's disease, and I'm starting a project on Parkinson's disease right now. But it's clear the ketones are beneficial in psychiatric disorders as well, and that their origin for ketones and the ketogenic diet has been used for epilepsy. So the brain is vulnerable to a whole slew of issues, probably more than any other organ in the body. So it's a very vulnerable system that faces issues from environmental challenges, and this is the evidence. In terms of parsimony, again, this is not my strength, but one of the points that to me is obvious with our emergence in Eastern and Southern Africa is that eventually, 80,000 years ago, the crossing to Australia was achieved and the minimum distance was 60 kilometers of open water. So I don't think you could see that far across the horizon to know that there was a landmass there. So the facility to move on the water and to be comfortable on the water was clearly present at this time in order to be accessible for this sort of travel. So again, we're still in that phase. We got into that phase, and in some ways we never left it. Kathy Stewart, who I mentioned here, her first paper, I believe, on the topic of fish remains in at Olduvai Gorge, where she worked with Lewis Leakey, was published in the Journal of Human Evolution in 1994. And she makes no reference to omega-3 fatty acids. She makes no reference to the brain. And in some ways, it was a naive paper in the nicest sense of the word, that she had saw no particular implications of fish intake for brain function. And I called her up. She worked in Ottawa and still is there. She's just retired. And I said, you know, I'm in Toronto. I want to come and see you because your paper is extremely important in terms of understanding the relationship that I've just been talking about. And we sat down, and she sort of, her eyes just opened up, and she said, I never realized that you know, these fish bones that I've been finding actually have some relevance to our evolution. And this is one of the images she showed with these purposeful cut marks on fish bones, particularly tilapia and catfish, which she found in abundance in East Africa. So these are freshwater fish that are relatively easy to catch. They didn't take any technology or tools or even hooks, which of course developed later. They're abundantly found in fossil sites in various places in Africa, and they're an excellent source of key building blocks for the brain. And this image I hadn't known about until Stephen Monroe spoke, was it last week or the week before, or the month before, but anyway, with these markings on shellfish. So shellfish have been in these remains and are well documented in Southern and Eastern Africa. And they're great packages, again, of brain-selective nutrients, the best sources of iodine and iron and other minerals, which you can't get from plants. And there are much less available from meat. So if we look at a summary of these points, I talk about shore-based, other people talk about other concepts of this wading and so on. I'm not really focused on the name, but rather the access to freshwater food resources. More definitely salt water as well, but saltwater beaches and shorelines, for the most part, as far as I know, are much less hospitable than the freshwater ones. And of course, we needed freshwater to drink anyway. So in estuaries and rivers and lakes, we definitely got to the saltwater sites and habitats, but there's nothing inadequate about the freshwater lake systems and estuaries that would not have met these nutrient requirements. There's more DHA in salmon and in saltwater fish, but those are much harder to catch. So again, I don't think there's any limitation to freshwater sites as having provided the nutrients that were necessary. The accessible nutrient-rich food supply, the source of brain-selective nutrients. And by the way, I think Mark, you mentioned in your last talk that the brain-specific nutrients, which is a term I believe I coined, I don't like it as much anymore because of course these nutrients are not just required by the brain, but I think so brain selective, if any of you choose to refer to this term, I would suggest that it's a bit more accurate because it would have helped for brain selection or brain evolution. In terms of the plausibility, again, the fish bones and shellfish are present in the hominid fossil beds and the vulnerability is still present. So we have not escaped that vulnerability. And a factor that's often ignored in these sort of discussions is that a reliable food supply would have given us time to develop language and time to develop the skills to make these tools. Because you don't just fashion and you know, when you're hungry, make a spear point and go out and hunt animals. You need time to develop the skills to hunt and to make these tools. And if you know that supper's available, you know, back at the beach somewhere, then it doesn't matter if you go out on a hunting trip and you don't find what you're looking for, because you know you can get back and to a reliable source of food. So I'd like to thank Algis for setting up this series. I think it takes people who are not necessarily trained in the speciality of paleoanthropology to see links, and people like Elaine Morgan to see beyond the limitations of some of the ideas that have been around for a long time, the conventional theories of brain evolution. I've tried to contribute a little bit to this story through survival of the fattest, being the fattest babies, of course, is what this is about. And then co-edited this book with Kathy Stewart, in which we were able to get some of the specialists who understand the fossil record better than I do to talk to the nutritionists and the biochemists and build a bridge. And then to do this again in a Journal of Human Evolution that came out 7 years ago, 8 years ago now. And some of the collaborators that I've had the pleasure of meeting and discussing this with. So thank you for your interest. Thank you again, Algis, for this sometimes thankless task of trying to herd cats and have this sort of discussion. And I look forward to chatting with you about it. Thank you.
Oh, well, thank you very much. That was brilliant, Stephen. So great. I mean, I just love the beauty and the simplicity of this idea of exaptation. That it's the your book title, The Survival of the Fattest, I think to me says it all. If you've got an infant that's fat for some reason, and then as a kind of an exaptation, they get a big brain from it. That is so beautiful. And of course, where would it make sense for an infant to be fat? It has to be on the water's edge, where it might drown. And it just seems to me that's such a beautiful idea. And of course, the business of stone tools, where better to start that process than cracking open a shellfish with a pebble? And of course, that's how that could have easily evolved. So I want to throw it straight open. I forgot to ask people to write questions in the chat, but who would like to go first? Just put your hand up. Malgazata's got a hand up already. Okay, so you go first, Malgazata.
Thank you very much, Algis, and I already expressed my admiration. This is really, really brilliant. And thank you very much, Stephen, and thank you very much, Algis, again for organizing these talks. I'm, you know, learning so much, and as I said, I would like every endurance runner to read this and to attend them, because this is like and I want to say that I really also appreciate Elaine is brilliant in writing about is a brilliant Darwinist in really grasping the idea correctly. Evolution does not have a purpose, and this teleology, I mean, like, you know, the purpose idea, like we evolved this in order to something, this creeps up all over the place constantly. So I think what Stephen has said, it's absolutely fantastic. You know, we change as long as it doesn't kill us and we can survive, we can change. It doesn't, you know, this, you know, it doesn't have this wrong idea of, you know, perfectioning. But what I wanted to ask Stephen, perhaps, if you were thinking, or would it make sense to think that perhaps also sclerosis multiplex, which is related to myelin, if I'm pronouncing this correctly, could have something to do with nutrition somehow? That's just one question. And I wanted to say that I came across recently, I haven't read it yet, about an article on shore foraging, and it doesn't refer to your research. It is from Paris though, so maybe I will put link in the chat. I don't know what it is worth, but you know, it's maybe some other people actually are coming, you know, to the same ideas. So maybe somebody wants to have a look. I will share the link in the chat. But I want to express my admiration and perhaps this little question about SM. What do you think?
Well, thank you for your comments. I missed the point. Your first question was about some condition or some, was it a disease?
Yes, sclerosis multiplex. This is a neurological condition referred to as SM usually. That's really quite a serious and debilitating disease as far, if I'm not seriously mistaken, because I'm not a...
Sclerosis.
It can be, it is related to myelin.
I don't know. I actually haven't heard of the disease. I'm not a physician anyway. But even if we knew that there was some effect on myelination, I'm not sure. Are you thinking that it's a deficiency of some minerals like copper?
Yeah, because you said that that copper actually has to do with
myelination, yes. It's possible. I'm not sure if there may be a genetic component that affects copper absorption, mm-hmm. like in certain some diseases. Menkes disease, for instance, is a hypomyelinating disease in humans, mm-hmm. but it's also quite rare.
More of them, I know. Mm-hmm.
Chris, did you want to have a question? I think Mark also knew what that condition was. So, because Mark is a physician, so do you want to just
multiple sclerosis? Multiple sclerosis, but I don't know whether it's had something to do with seafood or so. I don't know.
I thought that I didn't understand.
Multiple sclerosis, MS. Multiplex.
Yeah, because
yes,
I used
MS.
MS.
Sorry.
MS. Okay. Yeah.
Yes, I know what multiple sclerosis is. I'm not sure if we can draw a direct link to certain minerals at this point.
Chris Knight, please. Chris Knight, you've got a question.
Yes, I suppose if I have a question, that is not one which I necessarily Stephen can answer any more than I can, because one of the main criticisms I get from colleagues talking about all this is they say, well, a theory which sort of seems to apply to the entire span of hominid evolution, and we now think that the glass common ancestor between pongids and hominids was maybe as far back as 8 million years ago. A theory which simply says throughout the entire eight million years, this theory can apply is less convincing perhaps than one which specifies particular fossils at particular periods. And of course, I know that many people here, Mark in particular, have been trying to do that. So that's, I suppose, a little bit more of a question, whether Stephen, you could specify a little bit more closely where we're talking about, because talking about modern humans going across the world and getting to Australia is a very different question from, say, Homo erectus 2 or even 2.5 million years ago. But more something which, and this isn't exactly a question, but more of a sort of comment, I suppose, is, brilliant, Stephen, you were focusing on what is it which prevents brain enlargement and looking at the costs and the vulnerabilities. And obviously that's the way to go rather than looking in terms of purposes and all that nonsense. But of course, one of the factors preventing, for example, our closest great ape relatives from having large brains is the fact that every mother is a single mum. She has to do everything all on her own. And one of the reasons for that, of course, is that female chimpanzees have to disperse quite widely because there's not very much food around, and therefore they can't forge alliances, and therefore they tend to get beaten up by the males who also practice infanticide quite a bit. And then the wonderful thing which has happened relatively recently, of course, is the proper discovery of bonobos who crossed to the south of the Congo River, found a wetland environment of absolute superabundance of resources. The females start foraging together, forming alliances, beat up any male who tries to harass them. And then suddenly you've got the beginnings of something rather different. Obviously only about 1 million years ago this started to happen, so they certainly haven't got anywhere near the kind of brain expansion that hominins did. But I suppose I'm just asking, Stephen, I mean, don't we need, as well as all the nutritional elements you've documented so brilliantly, we need the grandmother hypothesis, Sarah Hurdy, all these Darwinians who recently have been pointing out that female strategies of alliance supporting each other in childcare, sharing the costs, sharing the vulnerabilities, as well as having clearly somewhere to stay where they can stay together. Other dry savanna females couldn't possibly form any kind of alliances because there's not enough food around. So I suppose that's another question to try to integrate what you're saying with what has now become almost mainstream. I would say mainstream, actually, namely the grandmother hypothesis and Sarah Herbie's mothers and others theory, which is now extremely mainstream, extremely influential.
I totally agree. I mean, I think we can focus this on women and mothers taking care of their young and being able to, and the infants being physiologically adapted for the opportunity to develop in the way that they can. So there's a biological element, but there's a social element, a cultural element, if you will, a habitat, and they all fit together. And I maybe made very superficial reference to that, but I totally agree.
Simon, have you got a question? And then Francesca.
Yes, thank you. Michael, that was brilliant. Thank you so much. I spoke to John Oates and Vernon Reynolds, who are great friends of mine, last week in London. We had a gathering of old colleagues, and they were asking questions about salty tears. And I remember Elaine Morgan saying something about it in the early days, but I haven't heard much since. And I wondered which other mammals have salty tears and whether salty tears would suggest that we had a marine rather than the freshwater habitat at some point. I know this is variable, but I wonder if you knew anything about that.
I'd prefer to not reveal my ignorance by trying to respond. So I'll pass the buck to whoever feels like responding.
I think that Elaine kind of pulled back on that. I think she made that point in The Aquatic Ape, which was, I think, 1980. And then by 1997, after quite a lot of criticism on the internet, she kind of withdrew it a little bit. So I'm not sure if that's one of the major arguments. So I don't really know. Francesca, do you have a question? You had your hand up a second ago.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, Stephen. Very interesting talk. I agree with all of this about the brain selective nutrients and how important they are. Slightly, in order to answer probably some naysayers' arguments that would say, well, if that's the case, why don't all aquatic animals have large brains? And that, I suppose, but they could include fish. Probably you're talking about mammalian brain rather than reptiles or other animals on the one hand. I don't know if that's something that specifically ties into your research. But also for me, I've been thinking more along the lines that brain nutrients are more the means, but not necessarily the reason. And although you said there doesn't need to be a reason, have you thought about the possibility that cold water diving could give a reason, a need to have a larger brain, because larger brains are less likely to freeze than smaller brains? And this is something I've noticed. There was a paper that came out recently about cetacean brains, and the researchers discovered that, in fact, I've got the title, is called Amplification of Potential Thermogenetic Mechanisms in Cetacean Brains Compared to Artiodactyl Brains. Whereby they say it's the actual need for, because they're deep sea divers, cold water divers, that they need to have bigger brains. And also the aquatic foods then provide the means for that to happen. And that might go some way to explaining why Neanderthals had the largest brains, because they were cold water divers. And also in erectus, we see that brain growth didn't really start until probably Java erectus, even African erectus, had a much bigger brain, of course, than the Australopithecines. It was not nearly as big as the later Java erectus. And then growth seemed to occur as the temperature fell, as seawater temperatures fell as well. So maybe there's a correlation there. Maybe it's something that ties the two together.
It's possible. I'll come to your first point, which was about the cetaceans and marine mammals. Of course, the dolphin has the biggest brain of all, and it's a marine carnivore, as opposed to the marine herbivores, which are don't have such a big brain. So, and it has a very sophisticated communication system as well. So the dolphin is an example of marine evolution that seems to coincide, if you will, or be coherent with this question of limiting nutrients and food supply and energy supply. In terms of cold water, I guess I prefer not to go there because I don't know enough to be able to sort of agree or counter. My concern is to focus on the infant. And is an infant going to survive in an environment where cold water is in proximity? If so, then let's explore the plausibility of these ideas and take them, as opposed to where the adults can go once they're capable of managing under cold water conditions. And you know, cold water is a big thermal demand on the body. And so there's going to be a competition. Obviously, if you're in cold water too long, of course, your ability to think goes down, apart from the muscles just getting seizing up. So I'm not comfortable exploring that idea at this point, but that doesn't make it wrong.
I'm just a bit conscious we're getting close to the hour. So does anyone want to ask a question or make a point that hasn't spoken yet? Mark, do you want to go?
Well, sea cows live in warm waters, but also have only plant foods. That's probably why they don't have large brains. They are aquatic, but they are the only aquatic mammals, as far as I know, that have rather small brains. Isn't it, Stephen?
I don't know how big they are, but I think
does it have to do with the cold water or with the plant food or with both? Well, I thought with the plant food, but Francesca might well be right. That this also has to do with the cold water. I'm not sure. The brain expansion begins early Pleistocene. That's at the same time of the cold, the ice ages. And that's when Homo erectus spread, probably along the southern Eurasian coast to Java and Flores and so. And that's when the brain enlargement begins. So, well, I wonder, Homo and Pan split 5 million years ago, but what happened to Homo in the beginning, we don't know. In my opinion, the Australopithecines have nothing to do with human evolution. They are more on the side of gorillas and chimpanzees. But what happened between these 5 million years ago and the beginning of the Ice Ages with Homo, where did they live? Did they live on Donakil, as Elaine thought, it's not impossible that they were on an island or so. They were perhaps in the Gulf or the Red Sea or Southern Asia. But I wonder, did the shell fishing begin soon after chimpanzees and humans split, or did it only begin in our branch with the ice ages when the temperatures fell? Also, what do we know about the abundance of oysters and mussels? Oyster and mussel banks, did they become much more abundant during the ice ages? That is, I don't know much about it, but I surely wanted to know whether this could be like that. When was mussels and oysters and what else and became more abundant? Was it with the ice ages? It's also possible. So still questions that we don't know.
But these things can be explored, and you could make a prediction based on what you just discussed, and it gives you a hypothesis to work from.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mark. We got Boleslav. Do you want to have a question?
Hello? Hello?
Hello, yeah, we can hear you.
Yes. I of course have one question. It's not a question, because I live because of paternal nutrition. And I think the specialist of these medicines, paternal nutrition, is know very well which micro elements really need to people. Each need to contact with some. My professor is sorry dead, who is helped me to leave. And I have another information about Pythagorean theory. I found very very interesting article about hominid footprint in Iceland Crete, and I can send you the article, but I can send to many people link to this article. It's a very interesting article, because maybe this started in Crete, and in European and Middle and Eastern Asia, not in Africa.
If you send me the link, I'll put it on the website. At the end of these talks, I always put the video on the website, and I'll make sure that your link is on there as well. Okay, well, I think we're past the hour. So unless anyone's got a last question, I'm going to stop recording. And I want to say thank you very much, Stephen, for a brilliant talk.
Thank you.
That was really fantastic and really excellent. So thank you.
Bravo. Thank you.